Hello everyone and welcome to this seminar on research avenues in pharmacognosy and phytochemistry. I'm K.S. Latta from Institute of Chemical Technology and I'll be discussing about the various research opportunities in the field of pharmacognosy and phytochemistry to you. Now before I get into the research opportunities, let me just take you through the herbals and the botanicals which are extensively being used in the different fields of the different sectors. Now these sectors includes medicine, the nutraceuticals, food and the beverages has good amount of plant part or the plant products which have been used into this. Cellulose and the fibers have been used into the textile as well as paper industry. Cardboard industry also. Triglycerides and waxes are extensively being used in lubricant industry. Terpenoids and the phenylpropanoids which are obtained from the aromatic plants are used in the perfumes and the flavor industry. Natural dyes which are present like henna in case henna or for that matter indigo are extensively been used as a hair dyes in the cosmetics and which is fast becoming more popular. Spirits and the liquors which are extensively been used by the society comes once again from the plant source. Leather which is obtained by tanning the hide, and for the tanning what you need actually the source of tannin, once again the tannins are been obtained from a plant like wattle tannin or for that matter marowalan tannin which are extensively used in the tanning industry coming from the plant. Besides this, biofertilizers, biopesticides and other biofuels, all of them are also coming from the plant source and extensively been used in the agricultural practices. Now let us talk about herbal technology. What do you mean by herbal technology? So herbal technology includes all the steps that are involved in converting botanical material into a medicine or the herbal product which ultimately goes to the consumer. Where standardization of the quality control with the proper integration of modern scientific technique and traditional knowledge will play an important role. Herbal medicinal products may vary in composition properties which is an inherent nature of a plant. However, correct identification and quality assurance of the starting material is therefore necessary, which will ensure reproducible quality of herbal medicine, which will contribute to its efficacy and safety part of it. When we talk about science and technology, a good amount of science is hidden in traditional knowledge, and there's a need to unearth this science and use that science for developing a technology for the mankind. Let us look at the challenges and the opportunities which exist in the sector. Now, when we talk about the plant products, certainly plant products comes actually from two sources. Either you get it from the wild source or from the cultivated source. Now, increasingly, industry want the plant material to be obtained from a cultivated source rather than the wild source, simply because under a cultivated source, you are able to control the quality of a plant in a better way. And for that, a good amount of inputs are required in the agrotechnology for medicinal plant. Another sector which needs a good amount of attention includes quality control of the raw material and the formulations. Now, well, this is a complex phenomena, but certainly actually we need to make a progress, and some amount of progress has already been made when it comes to the raw material in terms of various pharmacopoeias, which has published monograph. However, certainly good amount of attention need to be paid for the devising quality control parameters for the formulations. Next sector which has good amount of opportunities to work includes extraction with renewable technology, wherein once you know one particular set of constituent or a class of constituent is useful for the biological action, in that case certainly extraction plays an important role to enrich that particular fraction and minimize the unwanted or the undesirable material from the plant. Besides this, phytochemicals or the phytoconstituents, the other important sector which need to work extensively, which will need a good amount of technological input, because these are the isolated chemicals which will lead up to further development in terms of its preparation of the derivatives, which can find altogether different application, or one can come out with a molecule with the improved properties. Isolating new leads, certainly when we talk about the isolating new leads, that means the compound which are so far unknown from the plant material, we need to find out those compounds, establish their identity, and thereafter certainly it will lead to the development of its pharmacological activity, and certainly in case if it shows a remarkable or pharmacological action, then certainly it can be converted into a medicine. Pharmacology and the clinical studies are another sector wherein good amount of inputs are required, unbiased, and good amount of inputs are required, which will certainly lead to the development of the formulation which will have certainly a medical benefit or pharmacological benefit, which will be I mean when we will come out actually with the formulation which will be work for sure. Development of the modern dosage form, this is another area wherein a good amount of effort are once again required to convert those traditional forms into a modern and more user-friendly form so that the customer has more acceptability to these forms rather than the old and the traditional forms, which at times some of them are messy and some of them are not comfortable to take it. Now let us look at the yeast sector and the various opportunities which exist in those sector. Now let us look at the agrotechnology wherein, which is specifically applicable to the medicinal plants. Now plant propagation is one area wherein actually there's a need to propagate the plant which will be high yielding, and high yielding in terms of both chemical constituent and in terms of the biomass, which will need a technique like plant tissue culture or sometimes transgenic plant, wherein actually you can have the added advantage of the chemical constituent by the transgenicity. Now just to give an important example of the chemo cultivars, now thyme exists in the 6 different chemo cultivars, which includes Thymus vulgaris, CT, that is a chemotype thymol, chemotype linalool, chemotype carvacrol, chemotype thujanol, chemotype geraniol, and chemotype terpineol. That means each type has a constituent which is constituent which is predominant in that, and accordingly certainly it is important that you should know which chemotype is being used accordingly, and the protocol can be applied appropriately. Besides this, hybridization can also play an important role in developing important varieties. Of course, hybridization has already contributed immensely in terms of the Sinchona, wherein the variety which are cultivated now are hybrids which yields high quinine content rather than the original variety. Other area where one can work in the agrotechnology includes improvement in the gum output. Well, gum are the polysaccharides which are extensively been used as a thickener or the suspending agent, or sometimes even in microencapsulation. So certainly we, you know, India, we have a lot of geographical variation and good amount of trees grows in the different regions. And this is one sector where actually the gum output can be increased by applying ethylene in terms of 2-chlorosulfosphonic acid, which can be injected to the xylem of the tree, and it can causes the gummosis, which in turn enhances the gum output. And now the time has come that we must produce the different gums and study the individual gums from the different species. And once we have the complete technical data on those individual species gum, then certainly better application can be found out from those gums. Besides this, gibberellic acid or the phytohormones, plant hormones can be used for increasing the biomass of the plant. And certainly in case if you increase the biomass, it will definitely improve the yield of the desired constituent in that, and also improve biomass. So these are the sectors which are open for the research and the development in agrotechnology. Next sector, standardization of the raw material, where already individual companies and the different groups have been involved into the development of the monographs of the herbals. And good amount of herbal monographs have been developed. However, still there are many herbs which need to be, standardized. Well, when we talk about the development of the monograph, there are 3 things which primarily involve. Number 1, identity, purity, and the safety aspect associated with it. And when we talk about the evaluation parameter, certainly the evaluation parameter we should include for the standardization should include organoleptic, microscopic, microscopic, physical, chemical, spectral, biological, and the pharmacological evaluation, and of course assay part of it in terms of the chemical constituent. Now a good amount of effort has already been made for preparation of the monograph when it comes to the raw material. However, there are quite a few Ayurvedic generic formulation. Say for example, we have a Trifalachurna, and even today we do not have a foolproof analytical protocol for this generic formulation. So there is a need to generate analytical protocol for generic Ayurvedic formulation, and this sector is wide open to work, and I think good amount of publication as well as useful protocol can be found out, which will be useful for governing the quality of the generic formulation, which will eventually help in the sector. Now let us talk about herbal drug analysis. When we talk about herbal drug analysis, what are the difficulties, what we come across, and how to overcome those difficulties. Now, before we talk about herbal drug analysis, let us understand what are the factors which influence the quality of the herbal raw material. Number one, herbal drugs are usually a mixture of many constituents. So certainly the question arises, what set of constituent or which constituent you will analyze. Number two, another problem which exists in the sector includes, in some cases, chemical constituents are still not fully known. So in that case, certainly the question arises, what you will analyze for. Selective analytical method is another area wherein you need reference compounds, and reference compounds at this moment are pretty expensive, which deters its application for the evaluation of the drug. Plant materials are chemically and naturally variable. This is an inherent nature of a plant material. Yes, they do vary in terms of chemical constituent, but yes, though they vary in terms of the chemical constituent, one should be able to find out, and accordingly, the latter part of the application can be manipulated. Chemo variety and the chemo cultivar exist. I have already cited the example of thymus. So certainly you have to understand which chemical variety is being used, and accordingly you can use that appropriate phytochemical for its evaluation. Another important factor which influences the quality includes source and the quality of raw material are variable. Yes, those are the problem associated with being natural, but though your incoming quality is variable, you cannot afford, when you use this raw material into your formulation, you cannot afford to make your final product inconsistent. And therefore it is important that though incoming quality is having a variable constituent, you need to offer the product which will have a consistent in nature. Besides this, there are the other factors which also contribute to the a chemical nature of the plant material, which includes harvesting, drying, storage, transportation, etc., etc. Well, when we talk about herbal drug analysis, what is the important analysis, importance of the analysis of the herbal product? Well, once you undertake analysis, certainly it will ensure high and consistent quality product. Batch after batch, one need to give the consistent product. When we talk about herbal drug analysis, it is always important to adopt modern analytical methods rather than the old and the traditional methods, because modern methods are more precise and more sensitive, and with the result, actually those should be the one which should be adopted for the quality control parameters. When we talk about the analysis, certainly we need to demonstrate the presence of the bioactive or the marker compound. Besides bioactive, the marker compound, plants are not just active because of the one or the two single constituent, but it is the all the constituents which are present in the plant, those are collectively being responsible for the activity of the plant. So in that case, it is very important that we should be able to show the presence of other constituent by way of fingerprint chromatograms. Besides this, whatever analytical methods we use it, those analytical methods must be completely or the fully validated, because only validated methods can ensure the quality of raw material as well as finished product. Well, it is easy to say, but it is very difficult, because the difficulty of the plant product is that each plant has many chemical constituents, and each constituent is present in a very small concentration. And the problem becomes more complex when it comes to the polyherbal mixture, wherein the quantity of the individual herb is very meager or very small, with the result in the final formulation, their quantity invariably is in terms of either nanograms or the micrograms, which poses a serious problem of its for its analysis, be it qualitative or quantification. So the question arises, what to analyze and how to analyze. I will demonstrate with the help of the case study what to analyze and how to analyze. Now let us look at this table wherein I have tabulated the four cup syrup which are by the different manufacturer, and I have listed all the ingredients as per their label claim along with their quantity. Now if you look at this table, you will find only four drugs which includes Kantakari, Tulsi, Vasaka and Glycyrrhiza glabra are the one which practically all the formulation have used it. So the question, what to analyze and how to analyze. What to analyze, ideally speaking, all the constituents which are present and which are made actually on the label claim must be analyzed. However, it is very difficult in practice to analyze all these constituents. So how to prioritize? So prioritize actually, you know, this is what the prioritize. Now, for example, now this sector, like cup syrup, now these are the four drugs which everybody has incorporated in their formulation. So if you have to prioritize, which drug you'll take it actually on the priority for the analysis. Now these are the four drugs from the formulation to be useful, to be taken actually as a analytical priorities. So to begin with that, actually, in this also, out of these four, Vasaka, that is Agathoda Vesica, is now found to be having the expectorant action. And amongst these four also, we should be first to take it up actually is Agathoda Vesica. That is Vasaka, which contains vasicin. And I think the product should be standardized for the vasicin content per 5 ml, rather than just mentioning Vasaka extract 200 mg or the 300 mg or 25 mg per 5 ml. I think we must come out with the vasicin content in that 5 ml. Okay, so what to analyze? So this is the, in terms of the priority, the one which are shaded should be useful, should be taken up for the analytical purpose, and how to analyze. Now, next slide. First, we have to first undertake actually the identification of this constituent. For example, in cup syrup, if you have decided to undertake an analysis on the basis of vasicin, so you have to first identify whether vasicin is present, and that can be done by the help of HPTLC or the TLC. So you can see here the TLC which has been developed. So this is a vasicin, and this is the track actually of a syrup, wherein you can see corresponding spot which is to the vasicin. That means qualitatively vasicin is found to be present in the cup syrup. Now once you know that qualitatively it is present, then of course you can also find out quantitatively with the help of a HPLC. So what to analyze and how to analyze. So what to analyze from the formulation is Vasaka, and in that vasicin. And how to analyze? Vasicin can be analyzed by the help of HPTLC for the qualitative purpose, and for the quantification it can be taken up by HPLC. However, for HPLC, what you will need is a marker compound, which is an expensive affair. Now, another example which I will give it to you in terms of analysis, what to analyze, how to analyze. This is a polyherbal product called MLC901 by Mulia, a private limited company in Singapore. Now, these are the herbs which are used in the formulation, and the company wanted to show the presence of all these herbs as per their label claim in the formulation, which was in the form of the capsule. And thereafter, they also wanted to have a quantification of this. So what we did, we took out one marker compound from the each of these herbs, like astragalus, pansenol, peony flori, floric acid, hydroxycyclofer yellow, thereafter amygdalin, then salvinolic acid, beta acerone, and tenofolin. So these are the constituents which are present in this drug. And initially, we showed the presence of this by way of HPTLC, like in this case, amygdalin. So these are the eight formulations which has been given to me, which were biologically active. So I have shown the presence actually of amygdalin in all the formulation. That means amygdalin is qualitatively present in the formulation. So is the case of puniflorine in all the formulation, or astragalocyte. In the sample, you can see astragalocyte being present in all the formulation. So the qualitative presence of this chemical constituent is shown with the help of HPTLC. Now, some of these constituents are also been taken up by quantification. So ligustylide by the quantification by the HPLC, or gallicosin by the HPLC, or ferritic acid by the HPLC, or polygalaxanthone by the HPLC. Now, this HPLC chromatogram looks quite clean, because you can see here the peak starts from the base and once again come back to the baseline. However, in herbal, especially in the polyherbal formulation, the major problem is the preparation of the sample, because if you don't take proper care in the sample, when you start with the HPLC, the pointer will go up and it will never touch back to the baseline unless you start taking for the washing purpose. So this is a major challenge in case of developing HPLC analytical method, that your sample need to be highly clean without compromising the analyte of the interest. Okay, so now this is the answer for what to analyze and how to analyze. Now next, move to the next sector, poisonous plants and Ayurvedic Shodhana Prakriya. Now, as you know, there are quite a few plants which are poisonous in nature, but in spite of their poisonous in nature, they are used in Ayurveda. Now, in Ayurveda, they call it Shodhana process or the Shodhana Prakriya, wherein actually the poisonous plant material are subjected to some treatment by which it is undergoing detoxification as well as potentiation. So what are the processes which are normally been used in Ayurveda? Ayurveda uses bhavana, that is lavigation, or swedna, which is boiling, or nimajjana, which is immersing in the drug in a certain liquid or the medium, or kanjika and the churandoka, which are nothing but the medium which are used for the treatment. As you know, the chemical constituents which are present in this toxic plant are the ones which are responsible for poisoning effect. So suddenly, this treatment is targeted towards those constituents which are poisonous in a nature. So let us understand what is the mechanism by which these chemical constituents are subjected to the treatment and what is happening in the process. Now, when it comes to the mechanism involved, now there are basically two types of mechanism. Number one, by inactivating the poisonous or the toxic principle, either by elimination or by modifying its chemical nature or the structure. Now, when you talk about swedan, let's say swedan, that means you are heating or the boiling. Now, gunja contains toxic principle called lactalbumin. So when the gunja is heated, lactalbumin is a protein. So suddenly when the gunja is heated with the boiling water and when the water vapors are subjected to the gunja, then certainly this water vapor causes inactivation of the denaturation of the protein which are toxic in a nature. So what is happening here in this case? So toxic principles are either by elimination or by modifying its chemical nature or structure. So here the chemically it is inactivated and thereby this toxic constituent is being rendered now therapeutically important. Our second important principle which undergoes in this mechanism includes reducing the concentration of the poisonous principle present in the drug to a safer level, thereby making it therapeutically active without any toxicity. For example, you have a bhajana, that is aconite, or you also have a colchicine containing plant material like langli, which is called Gulurusa superba, which is used in Ayurveda. So these are the alkaloid containing plant material wherein the concentration which is present of this alkaloid are in a high and which are in toxic range. So certainly these plant materials are treated in such a fashion with medium, invariably either gomutra and the godugda or sometimes tannins, by which these concentrations of toxic constituent like alkaloids in this particular case, like in case of aconite, which contains aconitine and noraconitine, which are toxic principle. So the process which has been recommended in Ayurveda is, in case of dholayantra, you treat with the gomutra for three prahar, and then wash with the water, and then of course swedana in dholayantra using cow milk for three prahar. That means each prahar comprises of the 3 hours. Now what is happening? Gomutra is alkaline in a nature. So when you treat any alkaloid with the gomutra, what is happening? This alkaloid, which is normally present in a plant in a form of a salt, gets converted into a free base. That means what it was hydrophilic, now it gets converted into a lipophilic. So thereafter, when you treat with the cow milk, which has a ghee in it and which is oily phase, so once it becomes lipophilic, the ghee which is present in that will have more affinity for the ghee, and it will go along with the ghee and it will get eliminated. So what is happening? This aconitine, which is present in a form of the salt, first it is converted into a free base, and thereafter when it is treated with the godugda, the dugda will carry a good amount of aconitine which is present, and only a small concentration will be left behind, and probably that is the concentration which is therapeutically active without any poisoning associated with it. Alright, this is what the study which was undertaken, wherein actually the conventional process, that means the traditional process which has been recommended by the Ayurveda, where you can see actually the concentration of the aconitine which was present to such an extent has been reduced from 4.5 a milligram, it has been reduced to 0.43. So these are the other things which we are suggested actually, instead of gomutra and the godugda, we suggested the other different mediums which can be made use of it, and you can see the result here. So you can see what is happening. The aconitine, which is a deadly poisonous, has been reduced from 4.577 milligram to 0.4543 after shodhana prakriya. So this is another sector which has been opened for the research and the development. Alright, so that was about the shodhana prakriya. Next is the extraction of herbals and the isolation of the phytochemicals. Well, Ayurvedic extracts, extraction was known to Ayurveda, and they have used very meticulously. If you look at these three different forms of the Ayurveda, which includes Kadha, Aswan Arishta, and Taila. Well, kada comprises of the decoction made from different plant materials like tulsi or cinnamon or ginger, which is nowadays recommended for the COVID for improving the immunity part of it. So kada, if you look at the kada, what is the medium which has been used? In kada, the medium which has been used is water. So water is a polar which has been used for the extraction of the constituents which are typically water soluble. As when Arishta are fermented decoction, the fermented infusion which are normally been used for the plant material which contains semi-polar kind of constituent like your steroids, which are not soluble in water but soluble in alcohol, and very naturally Aswarishta are the product wherein the in situ alcohol is being generated, which in turn is involved in the extraction of the useful constituent from the plant material. Now you have another form called taila, which is oils wherein the herbs are extracted in the oil. And if you look at the oil, invariably the sesame oil or the gingerly oil is the one which has been used, and sesame oil is highly non-polar. So if you look at Ayurveda, what they have done, they have used all the three solvents, which is water, non-polar solvent, to alcohol, semi-polar, and oil, which is non-polar, based upon the individual herb and the kind of the constituent which is present in that and their solubility in appropriate medium, and accordingly those mediums have been used. So Ayurveda has meticulously used the extraction processes and the mediums for the extraction of polar, non-polar, and the semi-polar constituent. Now let's look at the phytochemicals. There is another sector which is of course latter part of the extraction. After extraction, what exists is the isolation of the phytochemicals. What are phytochemicals? Now phytochemicals are compounds which are reported to be present in the plant material whose identity and the purity is been confirmed. It may be one of the important compounds when it comes to the herbs. That means it may be a biologically active or pharmacologically active compound, or it can, or it may be just a marker compound, which is a major compound present in that. It can be isolated from the plant material or made synthetically. Yes, invariably these are normally been obtained from the plant material because most of these molecules are quite complicated. However, it is not necessary that you should always get it from the plant. In case if it is possible to make it synthetically and in an easier way, I don't think there is any reason why synthetic molecules should not be accepted. For example, quercetin can be easily converted from rutin by a single step process called the acid hydrolysis. So there is no point in isolating quercetin, which is normally been present in a very low concentration in the plant. On the other hand, rutin is present in a good concentration in the fibrocarbon species. So the rutin can be isolated from the plant, and if you want quercetin can be conveniently made from the rutin rather than isolating from the plant. Alright, so these are some of the phytochemicals. On the left side you can see some of the phytochemicals which are used in the other sector, where on the right side those are the ones which are used in nutraceutical and the pharmaceutical. For example, you have a menthol, lausone, annatto, indigo and vanillin, which are used in the different sector. Like menthol is used as a coolant, lausone as a dye and the annatto as a dye, indigo hair dye, vanillin as a flavor, gallic acid and the gallates, which are once again coming from the plant, are used as an antioxidant. On the right side, you have a carrageen, which is used as a pesticide, phoscoline as a obesity agent, piperine as a bioavailability enhancer agent, so as a flavone for a phyto, it's a phytohormones, ellagic acid, which is an antioxidant, which has been obtained once again from the marrowbala. So these are the phytochemicals which are already in use from the plant. Now let's look at the need for the extraction, the isolation. Now, what is the need for the extraction isolation? One, to get refined product. For example, you get shilajit. Shilajit typically comes actually from rock exudate. That means the exudate which comes actually from the rock represent shilajit. Thereafter, it has been taken to the laboratory and then it has been boiled in certain medium, invariably in the tannins, and then what results into a shuddha shilajit, which is free from the rock. To remove unwanted material, once you know that this particular chemical constituent or a set of chemical constituent which is useful, for example, in case of ashwagandha, now you have a steroids. So certainly if the steroids are the ones which are responsible for its immunity, in that case it is important to remove the unwanted material and improve the percentage of the desired constituent in that. To formulate into a suitable product, Once you remove undesired material, certainly it will provide better room for you to formulate or to prepare convenient dosage forms to make it more potent and reduce the drug or reduce the dose of a drug. For example, orange oil and orange oil aldehyde. So the other two products, orange oil aldehyde is also known in the market as a folded oil. Now, natural orange oil comprises of almost 90% comprises of a limonene, which is hydrocarbon, and 5% is the total aldehyde, which are responsible for its characteristic smell. When we talk about the folded orange oil in which selectively hydrocarbon part, which is the limonene part, has been removed by the fractional distillation, and the aldehyde part, which is present naturally in the 5%, it has been raised to almost 60+%. So certainly once it is raised to 60+%, certainly it provides better scope to utilize that, because orange oil is normally been used as a flavor in aqueous based products. So if you use natural orange oil as such, it will have a less aroma, but if you use folded orange oil, certainly it will give better aroma. So this you can see actually, so once you make it more potent, certainly it provides better room for the application. Now, another important reason why we need to undertake extraction isolation is to evaluate and assess dose determination. Now, as I told you in the earlier slide, we need to find out what is the dose of the vasicin which is required to be delivered in 5 ml so that it can give the expectorant action. So for that, you need vasicin. So to determine the exact dose of the vasicin, number one, you need to extract and isolate vasicin and then undertake the pharmacological action. And thereafter, to monitor presence of vasicin in the formulation, you need vasicin. So in either case, you need for the pharmacological action as well as for the quality control, you need these phytochemicals. Once you extract and isolate phytochemicals, certainly it will lead to the development of the suitable derivatives, which are more potent and added advantage, because many times it has been observed that natural molecules do suffer with some physicochemical properties. For example, you have artemisinin natural, which is used as an anti-malarial drug, but natural artemisinin is having the problem that it is neither water soluble nor oil soluble, that is neither hydrophilic nor lipophilic. With the result, onset of action takes a longer period. And with the result, once this artemisinin molecule was made available, then it was scientists were converting to a hydroxy artemisinin or the hydroartemisinin, which is further modified to artemether or the artiether, which are more lipophilic, or artesunate, which is succinic acid derivative of artemisinin, which is more hydrophilic. So certainly, once you know the chemical structure of a molecule, then one can prepare the derivatives which are having some improved properties associated with it. Another sector why the extraction should be carried out is to mimic the traditional processes, or to purify the compounds for the further processing, or to assess the compounds for the characterization, etc. All right. So these are some of the examples from the plant. Now let us look at galligine. Galligine actually is a guanidine derivative. It's called the isopentenyl guanidine or dimethyl allyl guanidine, which is present in a goat roux or the Galliga officinalis. And this was found to be having a hypoglycemic action. And the structure of the galligine was extracted, isolated, and characterized. And this has led to the development of anti-diabetic drug called butformin, that is butyl biguanidine or phenethyl biguanidine or N-dimethyl biguanidine, which is called the metformin, which is extensively used today anti-diabetic drug. So once you extract, isolate, and establish the structure, certainly it can develop into the synthetic, it can lead to the development of the synthetic analogs, which are more useful and with the lesser side effect. Another example is the quinine. Today, of course, has been talked about the hydroxychloroquine. So this was possible only because the quinine was extracted, isolated, and the structure was put forward. And once the quinine structure was put forward, the chemists, they have been able to synthesize the molecule, which is now, which can be made into a laboratory. At the same time, this molecule is better than the natural molecule for the anti-malarial action. And now, of course, it is also being found this application as an antiviral drug. Another reason actually why we should be able to undertake extraction isolation. Now this is an example of a menthol, wherein menthol is used as a cooling agent. However, menthol do suffer with some problem, because one major problem of the menthol, that when you take menthol or when you apply menthol, the cooling sensation loses very soon. That means the natural molecule, though it is a good molecule, but it is having certain problem associated with it, the action is long lasting or the longer lasting. So certainly one can modify this molecule. So if you look at the strategy here, so the molecule, this is the menthol molecule. This is a menthol molecule, so it has a hydroxy group at the C position. Now the menthol, if it has been converted into a bulkier molecule, certainly it will lose its cooling sensation to some extent. However, it will give the cooling sensation for a longer period. So though by modifying it, you may compromise the cooling sensation, but certainly you can enhance another property. That means now the cooling sensation can last for a longer period. Now once this has been achieved, then scientists have further gone ahead, they are converting to a 3-carboxylic acid. That means hydroxy group of the menthol has been converted to carboxylic acid group. And now this carboxylic acid group can provide further modification scope. Then it has led to the development of the WS3, which is nothing but carboxamide. And this carboxamide, that is WS3, is now found to be having cooling sensation more than the menthol, and at the same time it is lasting, you know, better than the natural menthol. So once the structure of the natural menthol is established, it can lead to the development of the, you know, compound, which is modified compound, which is better than in terms of the cooling as well in terms of the duration of the action. Another example of development of aloe-based product. Now, as you know, aloe contains barbaloin. This is yellow sap, which is oozing out from that, which contains barbaloin. This is the structure of the barbaloin, and this is the isolated barbaloin. Now, barbaloin is anthraquinone glycoside, which is a purgatory in nature. Now, this is barbaloin. Now, barbaloin can be converted into aloe-budding. That means the sugar has been knocked off by oxidative hydrolysis, by using ferric chloride and the hydrochloric acid. So once it is hydrolyzed oxidatively, it can get converted into an aloe-amorine. This is called aloe-amorine. So see, sugar has been knocked off. Now this aloe-amorine is further oxidized to the rhine. Now this CH2OH group is oxidized to a carboxylic acid group, so the compound becomes rhine. And now this rhine, this 1,8-dihydroxy compound, can be acetylated, and then the resultant compound will be a diacetyl rhine, which is nothing but a diacerine. Now, diacerine is having anti-arthritic action, which is quite different than the original compound, which is having the purgative action. So here is another example wherein extraction, the isolation, and further modification can lead to the compound which is altogether having the different pharmacological action. All right, I'll just go through a couple of case studies of extraction, the isolation. This is about the marmalosin, which is present, which is a furanocoumarin, which is present in bale. So marmalosin is a furanocoumarin derivative obtained from aegyl marmalose, which is a bale. I'll skip through this. Now this is the extraction process which has been undertaken. So extracted with the methanol, thereafter it is fractionated with the petroleum ether, and of course it has been repeated number of times, which eventually leads to the separation of a marmalosin, which is a phenyl furanocoumarin present in the aegyl marmalose. And once you extract and isolate marmalosin, certainly this is about identification of the marmalosin. Then this is determining the purity. You can see a quite clean peak resulting from the HPLC, indicating that the compound is quite pure. And once you have marmalosin, marmalosin is present in so many plant materials. So in case if these plant materials are used, certainly the quality of these plant materials can be tracked by tracking the marmalosin being present in the raw material as well as the product which has been made from this plant material. Next example is the sesamine. Now, sesame oil is the one which is extensively been used in Ayurveda because this oil contains sesamol, which is a phenol, sesamine, and sesamolin. Ayurvedic oil prefers sesame oil over any other oil. The reason being sesamol, because this is a phenol which prevents its rancidification. And with the result, this particular oil is preferred. Now, since sesame oil is expensive and is likely to get adulterated with the other oils, so it is important that one should be able to find out the qualitative as well as the quantitative presence of the sesame oil in the product. And for that, sesamine can be used as a marker compound. So this is a case study for isolation, extraction, the isolation of a sesamine. So this is about the sesamine extraction isolation, wherein actually the oil has been used for the separation of the sesamine. Oil is first converted into a soap. And sesamine, which does not have any phenolic constituent, does not react with the NaOH, which is normally used for the soap formation. So rest of the triglycerides, they are forming the soap, that means sodium salt of the fatty acid, whereas sesamin remains unreacted. Thereafter, it has been, the entire soup has been extracted with the ethyl acetate, wherein the good amount of sesamin gets extracted with the ethyl acetate. Thereafter, the ethyl acetate has been purified with the help of the methanol and the petroleum ether, which ultimately leads to the separation of the sesamin. Now, once you have a sesamin, this is a sesamin. It is found to be present by the TLC, and later on, it is the purity of the sesamin is also been confirmed by the HPLC. And once you have a sesamin, it is possible to find out the presence of sesamin in the bark of Phagara, which also contains sesamin, or the Piper mulesca, which also contains sesamin, or the fruit of Piper luana, which also contains sesamin, and of course, a lot of Ayurvedic oil which contains sesame oil. So these are the case studies which involves extraction, the isolation of the phytochemicals and their application for the analysis of the raw material or even the food, finished product. Another case study is agnoside and the nicotoside. Agnoside and nicotosides are iridoglycosides, so the iridoglycosides which is present in the vitex nicotum. So this can be extracted and isolated, and thereafter those can be used actually for the presence in the plant material or in the formulation which are made by using nirgundi. Nirgundi is used in the oil, and hence these products can be evaluated with the help of nicotoside and agnoside. Another area which can be taken up, modification of a starch. Now, normally starch is present in various plant materials, especially in the subterranean part of the plant. Now, we have taken up a project on the ginger and turmeric, which are basically an industrial byproduct, because ginger is used for separating oleoresin, the turmeric is used for separation of curcuminide. And once this oleoresin and the curcuminide has been separated, the leftover material we are using it for the separation of a starch and of course modification of a starch. However, the technique can also be applied to the different starches which are obtained from the different sources. So there are many plants which have a starch, and each starch have a different physicochemical properties. And once we extract and separate starch, this modification can be undertaken. So starch typically has modification. Two groups can be modified. Either you have OH group or CH2OH group which can be modified. So either it can be esterified or it can be esterified. But with a very minor modification, the property of the starch can be changed to a great extent. For example, here you can see a native ginger starch which has 37.9% sinensis. That means when you make a gel actually and then subject it to freezing and the thawing, after thawing it releases almost 37.9% of the water. So this is the property of the natural starch, wherein once it is modified, that means once it is converted into acid starch, it is only 5% starch. That means now it has a better holding capacity of water than the native starch or the original starch. So like that, one can undertake the various modification of the starch, and it will definitely change its properties, and those properties can be made use of it for the various application, either in the food sector or in the pharma sector. Well, another area where a good opportunity lies is development of the herbal products. When we talk about the development of the herbal products, certainly there's a need for the clinical trials. If herbal medicine to play a significant role in the future healthcare, the therapeutic effects of the individual herbs must be carefully evaluated by well-designed, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled studies involving a significant number of human volunteers. And this study should be unbiased, and whatever result comes out, I think we should be able to the further pharmacology action or the formulation of that should be based upon the concrete information which comes out from this kind of study. Now, once biological activity gets established of a particular herb or maybe a combination of the herbs, then obviously the next criteria comes into the picture is standardization of the phytoequivalence. That means once biological action of a single herb or a formulation, that means the combination of the many herbs has been established, thereafter one should get into the standardization. That means now establishing the evaluation parameter. So once the activity is established by clinical trials, it is necessary to standardize that activity to make certain that a uniform amount of it is present in each dosage unit. This can be very complex, as the activity is not due to a single chemical entity, but to a mixture of the chemical constituents. And for that, what you need is a chemical profiling, that means using marker compound, that is phytoconstituents, and also clinical studies followed by the chemical profiling is called the phytoequivalent. That means the biologically active drug or a formulation should be used up actually for establishing quality control parameters for the constituents which are present on those formulations which are found to be biologically active. So while phytoequivalence is a good, but product must be pharmacologically or therapeutically active. That is very important. That means only after establishing the pharmacological action, this translation work should be taken up. Now, while coming up with the formulation, I think the good amount of attention should be paid on the importance of the excipient and the diluents, which are normally been made use of it. Now, it has been observed actually in some cases, some plant material do react with other constituents. For example, St. John Wort's was found to be interfering with other drugs. So in that case, certainly this kind of information need to be studied for more and more herbal drugs, because herbal drugs are normally been used by the people or by the consumer while concurrently going on the modern or the allopathic medicine. Bioliability is another sector which has not been worked extensively in case of the herbal product. And as we know, though we are taking good amount of curcuminide, but there's a question mark about its bioliability. So certainly bioliability is very important study we need to be undertaken, especially for the herbal formulation. When we undertake this herbal formulation development, even before that, I think the bioliability must be first checked, and thereafter only undertaken the formulation development work. All right, drug approval and the quality standards. Once we undertake this development of the formulation, when the botanical medicine is fully developed, then of course herbal product will be approved by the FDA. Such approval would bring about the establishment of the required standard of the quality for phytomedicine. And thereafter, doctors and the pharmacists will prescribe or recommend both phytomedicine as well as synthetic medicine for various conditions, depending on which is deemed to be more appropriate for that particular ailment. Herbal medicine will become then integrated with the conventional medicine, and the words like alternative or complementary will no longer be appropriate and will no longer be used, but it will go concurrent medicine along with the modern medicine. Another sector which we must pay attention is development of the modern dosage forms. Now I just put two examples. One is traditional Amla Murabba and the Aula Candy, and second is Taila and the Spray. So these are the old traditional forms and these are the new forms. So the old traditional forms, wherever they are not convenient or user-friendly, I think there is a need to convert them into a more user-friendly form, because once you convert them to a more user-friendly form, certainly the acceptability improves. And this is another area where people need to work extensively to convert them, to convert traditional old traditional forms without losing its medical benefit into a modern dosage form which are more user-friendly. All right, so those are the different research opportunities which exist in the field, which I have highlighted. I have come to an end to this seminar. Now let me sincerely thank to all the participants, staff, management of MET's Institute of Pharmacy, Nasik. Thank you very much. Thank you, one and all.